CEO and Director, IDBI Federal Life Insurance. We welcome you, sir.
Our request, Dr. G. Gopala Krishnan, Director, BIMHRD, to welcome Mr. Vighnesh Shahane with a bouquet.
Every 3 months, it turns on its head for the last many years. So that's the kind of uncertainty and complexity you should expect when you enter the corporate world. What I'm going to speak for the next 40-45 minutes, what I'm going to tell you is just from my heart. As you can see, I have no PowerPoint presentation. I have no notes. I'm just going to speak from my heart. But these are not Vighnesh Shahane's pearls of wisdom. These are lessons I've learned making a whole lot of mistakes, and I encourage you to make mistakes, make a lot of mistakes and learn, and observing keenly and noticing winners and leaders and CEOs at close quarters. So this is a distilled wisdom I'm giving you, making my observations. These are not my pearls of wisdom. As Timothy mentioned, I played for Bombay in the Ranji Trophy. Yes, I did 25 years back, for 3 years. And I can tell you with a lot of honesty and a lot of conviction that what I learned on the cricket field was far, far more than whatever I've learned in any boardroom or any classroom. Okay, sport is essential. Sport taught me humility. Sport taught me to remain grounded. Sport taught me to be a team player, to play for the team, very critical in your corporate life. Sport taught me never let success go to your head and never let failure go to your heart. Remember that. Sport did all that for me. What I'm going to say now is basically, I mean, there are textbooks and books and dreams of pages written on how you navigate the choppy waters in corporate world, or you climb up the corporate ladder, and how you become a successful CEO. And all of that is true. But what I'm going to share with you now are 7 lessons that had a great impact on me, have benefited me, have worked for me. Practical lessons, I give you practical examples, and I imbibe these all the time. So here goes. The first one which I want to speak about is belief, self-belief. You all know what self-belief is. Belief is a conviction that something, it's a certainty that something is going to happen. If that certainty is strong, the self-belief in you is strong. Now I want you to imagine 2 cans of paint, okay? One can of black paint and 1 can of white paint. Now the white paint is the can of self-belief and conviction. And the black paint is the can of doubt and negativity. If you add 1 drop of black paint to the can of white paint, it becomes gray. Isn't that right?
Yes, sir.
One drop of black paint will make the entire white paint gray. But you have to add a whole lot of white paint to the black paint to make it gray. Correct?
Yes.
That is the power of negativity. That is the power negativity and doubt has. One negative thought, one stray doubt can cloud, can hamper, can set you back, can disturb your entire positive thinking. So be positive. Don't let negativity creep in. Don't let even a single doubt. Because one drop, remember that doubt is like 1 drop of black paint. 1 drop of black paint can make your whole white paint gray. Okay, so never let doubt creep in. I'll give you examples that you will relate with on belief and self-belief. For a long time, I don't know how many of you are sportsmen or interested in sports, but for a long time, long time, probably before you were even born, running a mile in 4 minutes was considered the holy grail of sports. Are you aware of that? Running a 4-minute mile was considered a great achievement in sport. In fact, sports coaches, trainers, doctors, psychologists, physiologists said it was impossible to run a mile in 4 minutes. They said it is a physical impossibility, it's a medical impossibility. No human being can run a mile in less than 4 minutes. They said that the lungs can't process oxygen that fast, the lungs would collapse, the heart would burst, the tendons, the ligaments, the bones would become brittle and break, and you would probably die. They said it's a medical and physical impossibility to run the mile in 4 minutes. But one man defied this law. He said that I will run the mile in 4 minutes. And that man was, you know who ran the first mile in 4 minutes? I believe you read the newspapers every day. Who ran the mile in first mile? Who ran the mile in 4 minutes? Who? Okay. This was way before you all thought. I don't expect you all to know. This was a man called Roger Bannister. Roger Bannister was the first man in 1954 to run the mile in less than 4 minutes. When the whole world said that it was a physical impossibility for any human being to run the mile in 4 minutes. But you know, that's not the great thing. You know what was the great thing? After Roger Bannister ran the mile in 4 minutes, and he showed the world that it can be run in 4 minutes, 100 runners in that year, all over the world, ran the mile in less than 4 minutes. Today, even school, university champions run the mile in less than 4 minutes. Every university in USA has 3 athletes who run the mile in less than 4 minutes. It required one Roger Bannister to show the world in 1954 that it was possible. And today you have a score of people running miles in less than 4 minutes. So that was belief. That is the power of self-belief. Another example I'll give you about self-belief is, you know who the first people to climb the Mount Everest, right? Edmund Hillary and? So they were the first people to climb the Mount Everest. And again, that was the greatest thing happened. After Edmund Hillary and the Sherpa Tenzing Norway climbed the Mount Everest, that year itself, more than 100 people climbed the Mount Everest. Today, I read about people climbing the Mount Everest from different sides, climbing it without oxygen, climbing it, different times of the year. And just recently, I read somebody who was handicapped also climbed the Mount Everest. So, the Mount Everest, which was supposed to be an unassailable peak, 8,848 meters high, impossible for human beings to climb, no oxygen. Edmund Hillary showed it can be done, and after that, everybody is doing it. So that is the power of self-belief. That is what belief, that's the magic belief can do. If people tell you it can't be done, prove to them it can be done, and you'll be surprised that if you do it, how many other people follow you and follow your footsteps. So that's the first lesson you should learn. Have a lot of self-belief. The second thing I want to speak about is attitude. Now, what is attitude? Attitude, to me, can't be defined. But attitude is a switch which turns everything on. If you master your attitude, you as well as master life. For a long time, you'll always have this debate on talent or attitude. What is more important? Is it more important to have talent? Is it more important to have the right attitude? I think talent can get you that far. But if you need to go further, I think attitude will take you there. Attitude is a master key that opens all doors. In fact, at a certain stage, at a certain level, talent actually becomes counterproductive. Talent breeds arrogance. Talent breeds an ego. Attitude keeps you grounded. And I'll give you an example about good attitude. All these pearls of wisdom that I'm going to tell you, I'm going to sprinkle them with a lot of real life examples which hopefully you relate to and get inspired by. There are 3 bricklayers laying bricks, on a hot sunny day. And somebody comes and asks the first guy, "What are you doing?" So he says, "You idiot, can't you see? I'm laying a brick. What are you asking me stupid questions for?" So he asks the second guy, "What are you doing?" So he's saying, "Can't you see? I'm building a wall. I'm laying bricks and building a wall. Why are you asking me stupid questions?" So he goes across and asks the third person, "What are you doing?" And the third person says, "I'm building bricks. I'm laying bricks to build a wall, to build a school. This school will teach 1,000 students every year. And out of these 1,000 students, at least 20 will change the world. That's called that. They all mean the same thing. They all mean the same thing, but see how each one saw it differently. One guy saw it as just laying bricks. The other guy said, no, I'm building a school which will teach 1,000 students every year. And out of those 1,000 students, at least 25 or 30 will change the way the world works. That is attitude. The third thing I want to speak about. So belief, self-belief, and attitude. Okay, very important. The third thing I want to speak about is commitment. Okay? What is commitment? Can anyone tell me what is commitment? What does commitment mean to you?
Completing your promise.
Yeah, exactly. I think you got it right. Commitment is sticking to your word. Somebody said sticking to your word. Commitment is doing what you said you'll do. Commitment does not answer questions of how, why. Commitment just says it has to be done, so it has to be done. There's a certainty in doing it. We don't question how. We don't ask why. We said we're going to do it, that means we're going to do it. Now, commitment does not mean doing manic, insane things. Okay, commitment does not mean that if something doesn't happen, you jump off the 10th floor of a building, or you run in front of a running train. Commitment doesn't mean all that. Commitment simply means, if you said you're going to make 10 sales calls that day, and if you made 9, and your friends are calling you out for a beer and a movie, and you're tempted to join them, but you committed to yourself, you'll do 10, and you'll do that 10 call. In between, the single moment. That is commitment. If you commit to spend time with your children, with your family, with your spouse, on the weekend, and there is work, and there is well, there are friends calling you, commitment to them is staying with them and spending time with them. That is commitment. Commitment is doing simple things, but getting them done. Commitment is not doing crazy things of, if you don't achieve a target, you jump in front of a train or commit suicide. That's not commitment. That's insanity. Commitment simply means doing what you say you will do. Okay? Have you ever seen a child, a small child, try and learning how to walk? The child will stumble, the child will fall, the child will get up, the child will fall, get up, fall again. Eventually, the child learns to walk. Children are the best teacher of commitment. That is commitment to you. The child doesn't give up because in his dictionary, he has to learn how to walk. There is no other way. He sees everybody walk and there is no other way. He can easily say that, I'm not going to walk, I'm going to just get to ask my parents to get a wheelchair for me. But child falls, stumbles, gets hurt, gets up, gets hurt again, but learns to walk. That is commitment. Companies will employ you for not what you know. They will employ you and pay you a salary for what you do with what you know. Companies will not pay you a salary for whom you know. They will employ you and pay you a salary for what you do with whom you know. And to do things, the two things that you know, or two things that you know need coming. Okay? It's not enough keeping it in your head. I know a lot of people, but I'm getting nothing done. You need commitment to get things done. Remember, we employ you to get things done. That is commitment. I'll give you an example of commitment. Somebody spoke about Edmund Hillary and Sherpa Tenzing. We all know they're the first people to climb the Mount Everest, right? But how many of you all know that Edmund Hillary made 8 unsuccessful attempts to climb the Mount Everest? In those 8 unsuccessful attempts, he lost 6 of his Sherpa guides. They died. Do you all know that?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You all know that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. There's another thing that happened to Edmund Hillary. When he was at base camp, his wife and his daughter came to visit him, and the plane they were flying in to visit him crashed. They died. He made 6 unsuccessful attempts. He lost 6 Sherpas. He lost his family in that endeavor to climb the Mount Everest. And he looked up at the Mount Everest and said, I'm not alone. I'm not going to let you beat me. I'm not going to let you beat me. You've beaten me so far, but I'm going to beat you one day. That was commitment. And then finally, on his eighth attempt, or ninth attempt, he succeeded with Shepard or tenth. That was commitment. That is commitment. He refused to accept defeat. You all have to refuse to accept defeat. Self-belief, attitude, commitment. Okay? These are three things. The fourth thing now which I'm going to talk to you about is probably the most important. Okay? I spoke about change. I spoke about complexity. I spoke about the industry, the corporate world, turning one's head 3-4 times. And nothing is constant in the corporate world of us. And it's seen more action and more change in the last 10 years than it's ever seen before. Starting with the global, the financial meltdown, the global crisis, the collapse of Lehman Brothers. After that, it's never been the same. All industries have been in a state of volatility and churn. Jack Welch, you know Jack Welch, that's the legendary CEO of General Electric. He once said, if the rate of change on the outside is more than the rate of change on the inside, the end is near. What he means is that if your industry, if the world outside you is changing faster than you, and you are refusing to accept that change and refusing to change, your end is near. You have to change. There's another saying on change which I like a lot. It says, it's not always that the strongest, fastest, most intelligent, and largest species survive. It is a species which is most likely to respond to change. That's going to survive. And that's so true. Today you see a lot of companies who were poster boys in the corporate world 10 years back, obsolete today. Why? Because they refuse to change. They refuse to change. Now there are 3 or 4 things about change I would like to tell you. Because this thing is the most important. Today when I'm standing in front of you, 800 of you all, on the threshold of an exciting career, I think you all should internalize the fact that the world is not going to, the day you enter the corporate life, the world's not going to be the same. It's going to change every day. Every day you need to expect change and expect to change with the change. It's the most important quality that I look for in people. How do they respond to change? Are they averse to change? Are they rigid? Are they stubborn? Or is the guy flexible, willing to change? That's very important. That's a quality a lot of corporates will look for when they hire people or when they promote people. The first thing about change you must realize is that change challenges your comfort zone. Okay? This means that change is not a monster. It's not an enemy. Change simply challenges the way you did things in the past. It challenges your comfort zone. Now, human beings are creatures of habit. Okay, we like to do things which we have been doing in the past, which are comfortable, which work for us. There's no reason why it should not work, okay? So let's do it, okay? But change challenges that comfort zone. And remember something, okay? When you start working, your growth will happen outside your comfort zone. Your growth will never happen in your comfort zone. The moment you push yourself out of your comfort zone is the day you start growing. You will start growing as a person, you will start growing as a professional, okay? It's like jumping into a cold shower, okay? You first feel cold, you first feel uncomfortable, you first feel jittery, shivery, but in a few seconds or minutes, you get used to the water. You jump into a pool, in the first few seconds you feel cold, the water's cold, but in a few seconds, a minute, you will start getting used to it, right? Because you decided to jump in. It's similarly, it's like taking a different route to office or work. You've taken one route for many years and someone says, maybe that route is shorter or there's less traffic, and you probably first you're averse to it, saying that no, I know, I've tried, I've been trying this route. So many times it happens to all of us, doesn't it? And then when we finally take that route, we find that yes, it was better. That is what change does. It's not a monster. Don't look at it as your enemy. Don't look at something that's going to, someone or something that's going to demolish you. Accept change, embrace change, jump into change. You only challenge your comfort zone because it's only telling you that I'm challenging your comfort zone because I want you to grow. That's the first thing you need to know about change. The second thing is positive turbulence, positive, listen to me, positive turbulence keeps you ahead of the curve. So if you're proactive about change, you will always be ahead of the curve. You will always be ahead of the curve. Now I'll give you an example. Who is the biggest star in the Indian film industry, Hindi film industry, Bollywood? Who said Amitabh Bachchan? Raise your hands. Okay, I think majority say Amitabh Bachchan. Yes, I think Amitabh Bachchan is the biggest star in the in Bollywood today. There are Shah Rukh, great actor, big star, but I think Amitabh Bachchan is the biggest star because he has endured over a period of 30, 40, 45 years. And anyone who lasts that long is a superstar. Now, again, Amitabh Bachchan, when he made his debut way before you were born, but when he made his debut in 1969 or 70, he was not the best looking film star. He didn't have the best physique. He was not even the best actor. He had a funny voice. He couldn't dance. He couldn't sing. And he was gawky looking. There were better films, there were better, looking actors with better physique, who danced better, who sang better, who did comedy better. But Amitabh made his debut. Okay? Now, over the years, the reason Amitabh Bachchan has endured and stayed is because he's kept reinventing himself. He's kept changing with the times. He started off with a very innocuous role. Then he shot to fame as the angry young man. You know that?
Yes.
He did comedy roles. He did serious roles. He became grandfather. He became godfather. Godfather, which movie? He did everything. Even today, he experiments with roles. He does different roles. And everybody who was at his time, because stars, they've all faded away. Why? Because they were unwilling to accept change and change. And Amitabh Bachchan was not the best looking, didn't have the best physique, didn't have six packs, couldn't dance, had a funny voice. But he's the biggest star today because he kept reinventing himself and he kept abreast with change and he kept changing. That is the importance of change. And that is where change can get you. And that's what positive turbulence will keep you ahead of the curve. Amitabh Bachchan said, I want to be proactive. I want to create positive turbulence. I don't want change to happen and I won't then react to it. I want to be proactive. I want to do stuff, preempt change and keep reinventing myself. How many of you like cricket? Okay, popular sport. Rahul Dravid. Great, great test batsman, right?
Yes, sir.
But was considered a strokeless wonder, was considered a liability to the team in one day cricket, right?
Yes.
He was in fact dropped from the Indian team. Selector said, he's not suited for one day cricket. He can't get the ball out of the square. He can't hit the ball for sixes and fours. He's too technically correct. And he's not fit to be in Indian cricket. He's not a great fielder. He's not fit to be in the Indian one day team. Now, Rahul Dravid was dropped from the Indian cricket one day side. He was a great test player, always a certainty. That was there. But Rahul Dravid, if you remember, he started keeping wickets to keep his place in the Indian team. He said, I'll become a wicket keeper. He batted at number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. He started keeping wickets. He did what it was. He kept reinventing himself, kept changing, kept himself abreast with change just to be in the Indian side. people who are more talented than him, people who are bigger hitters, people who are supposed to be great players or great one-day players, came and went. But Rahul Dravid endured. At the end of his career, and very few people achieved that, Rahul Dravid had played more than 300 one-days and scored more than 10,000 runs at an average of 45. And that is greatness in any form of cricket. A person who was dropped from the Indian team, was not fit to be a one-day player, was said, was criticized that he's too technically correct, finished his career as one of the all-time greats in world cricket in one-day cricket. Not because he changed his style of play. It's not that Rahul Dravid came the next day and started hitting sixes and fours. He was yet playing that same cricket he played, but he kept changing. He kept changing to a situation. He kept wickets when required. He batted number six when required. He didn't want the captain of stroll. He kept reinventing himself. That is the power of change. That is the power of positive turbulence. Keep you ahead of your curve. Amitabh Bachchan, Rahul Dravid, and I can go on with so many more examples. In the interest of time, I have won. Finally, about change. Change is risky. But not changing is even more risky. Now, I'll give you an example again. Do you know what the national sport of India is?
Hockey.
Very good, yeah. Very, very good. You know, a lot of times when I ask this question, people say cricket. Cricket, crazy country like India, it's very easy to forget that hockey is the national sport. Now, do you know that India were the champions of hockey, the pioneers of hockey?
Yes, sir.
India taught the world how to play hockey. We had great players like Dhyanchand, who actually was reserved. He taught the world how to play hockey. Between 1928 and 1956, India won all the Olympic gold medals in hockey. India was an undisputed powerhouse of hockey in the world. Undisputed. Today, India struggles to qualify for world championships. India struggles to finish even in the top 6 or 7 in the Olympics or in the Commonwealth Games. India struggles to even get an Asian medal gold. Why did that happen? Why did that happen? Because after 1970, there was a change in the way hockey was played. Hockey moved from grass to AstroTurf. AstroTurf is a much faster surface and you need a different style of play. Indians refused to accept that. Indians thought, we are champions on grass, we'll also be champions on AstroTurf. What happened was, the death of Indian hockey happened. Indian hockey collapsed and it has reached depths, once in a while we do well now, but it has reached depths which are embarrassing. India refused to accept that the world is moving ahead. We have to change. We have to change the way we play. The days of Dhyanchand were great, but they're over. Hockey has become a much faster game now. A small country like Holland would be the size of, would have a population less than Pune. Has 700 AstroTurf grounds for hockey. Melbourne, which is a city in Australia, has 400 AstroTurf grounds for hockey. Do you know how many AstroTurf grounds India has? 40. A country like India has 40 AstroTurf grounds only, and that's who recently built. And that is the reason why India lost its dominance in world hockey. They refused to change. The world changed. The world changed to AstroTurf, faster surface. India refused. And the results are therefore. So change, dear friends, is very important. Remember that you have to be flexible. You know, probably what you did, what you learned all these years, what your experience has taught you, probably when you enter corporate world, you will feel that it's obsolete. It has to change. And there's no harm, there's no shame. So what? Fine. My parents told me something, my professors taught me something, my friends believed in something, I thought something would work, but no, that's not the way it works here. I need to change. And change. Be proactive and change. Don't hold on to the past. Okay? Promise me you won't.
Yes, sir.
Great. Be flexible, be ready, and embrace change. Change is your friend. Change will take you to places where you never thought you'd go. Okay? So self-belief, attitude, commitment,
change.
Four things. The fifth thing I will tell you is building your brand. Okay? You have to know, you have to realize that even today, there is a book being written on you, page by page. If I speak to your professors, directors, colleagues, friends, parents, relatives, I can get so much information about you that I don't even need to meet you. Are you aware? And now with social media, I really don't need to meet you at all. I can know all about you without meeting you. There is a book being written on you, page by page. That book is your brand. When you enter the corporate world, there will be more people writing this book. There will be your bosses, there will be your competitors, there will be your colleagues, there will be your peers, there will be your subordinates, there will be your people reporting to you. They will all be writing this book for you page after page. Be very careful as to how each page is written. Hold your reputation, preserve it, protect it. Okay, because it just takes, like I gave an example of black paint and white paint, a reputation takes a long time to build, but it takes minutes to destroy. Protect your reputation, create your brand. Know that there is a book being written from you, okay? Even today, there is a book being written from you. I can find out everything about Sumati, Lokesh, Akansha, anybody, but not even meeting them. And now with social media, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, what have you, I really don't need to meet you. Okay, be careful, create your brand. There's a book being written on you. That's the fifth thing.
Am I keeping good time? Keeping good time, no?
Yes, sir.
Sixth thing is IQ versus EQ. Now, all of you graduating from this wonderful college, great facilities, great directors, show you a great faculty. Y'all will be very good on IQ. IQ will get you far. There's no doubt in my mind that your IQ will take you places. But I spoke to you about talent and attitude. The same analogy is between IQ and EQ. Now I can't define EQ. I don't know what EQ is. But EQ simply means having an empathy for people, having your finger on the pulse of the people you work with, who report to you, who you work for, and empathizing with them, being a team player, being humane, understanding people. People don't know how much, people don't care how much you know. People care how much you care about them. And not seeing the world through an Excel spreadsheet. You know, the trap a lot of students, and all the y'all are going to enter corporate world is just out of college, is that a lot of y'all will start seeing the world through an Excel spreadsheet. The real world is not an Excel spreadsheet. There's a lot of hope, there's a lot of insecurity, there's a lot of security, there's a lot of ambition, there's a lot of human emotions at play. And tap into these human emotions. So the day you tap the people you work for, the day you crack your people, you crack your business. Because people are the biggest differentiators. Okay, don't view people as a number, don't view them through an Excel spreadsheet. Okay, that is EQ, according to me. Okay? So IQ versus EQ. Your IQ will get you this far, your EQ will take you further. So develop the human side, okay? Connect with people, connect with your team. Travel, when you start working, travel. You know, I travel a hell of a lot. And sometimes when I travel to a far off location on a weekend, I sacrifice family life. And I say that, why did I need to come all the way here? I could have said the same thing on the phone. I could have said the same thing on email. I could have said the same thing on video call if I could. They could have seen me. I could have said the same thing about Skype. But business is all about showing up. When you show up, there is commitment. The other person knows that this guy is committed. He's traveled all these miles to come and tell me something you could have told me on the phone. Business is all about showing up. So get that people connect. Get a connect to people. Don't sit in a chair and become armchair manager and see the world through an Excel spreadsheet. Okay, the real world is in the trenches. Go out in the trenches. Learn. Get hit. Make mistakes. That's how you're going to grow professionally. And there's a seventh thing which I want to speak to you about, which is very, very critical. But again, it's something I can't put a finger to. It's called integrity. Now, integrity, I won't even try to define what integrity is, because integrity means different things to different people. The way I define integrity is, if I can look at myself in the mirror at night and have a peaceful sleep at night with a clear conscience, and if I've not done anything against my personal value system, I've been okay. Okay, I don't want to define what integrity is to you. I don't want to say you need to do this, you need to do that, because integrity means different things to different people. But you should be able to look at yourself in the mirror, have a good night's sleep, and don't do anything which is against your personal value system, which your professor, which your parents have taught you. Okay, if I tell you something, if I tell you, for example, if I tell you that a man stole 100 rupees, you would say he's a thief, isn't it? You would say he's a thief. But if I told you that this man stole 100 rupees to feed his hungry children who had been starving for 3 days and buy bread and buy food for them, your whole perspective would change, isn't it?
Yes,
sir. So I don't want to get into definitions of integrity, because it means different things to different people in different circumstances. But don't do anything against your personal values. Okay, whatever temptations are in corporate life, don't do things which are against your values. There's no shortcut to the top. There really isn't any shortcut to the top. You need to take the staircase to the top. So if you take the staircase to the top, you'll stay at the top. Don't try to take the elevator to the top. So the elevator will get you down also. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So self-belief. Now, the last thing I want to tell you, a lot of people, when I was entering the corporate world, and I was also a student like yours 20 years back, I did my MBA through Narasimha Monji Institute of Management Studies in Mumbai in 96. People used to tell me that, the corporate world is a slimy world. It's a difficult world. There are choppy waters. You have to be on your feet, on your toes all the time to navigate and survive in this world. You have to be political. You have to be cunning. You have to be slimy. You have to be sly. A lot of people told me that, you can't be too naive. You can't be too nice in the corporate world. Because in the eternal life, there are sharks in the corporate world waiting for you. Let me tell you something. All that is hogwash. You don't have to be political. You don't have to be cunning. You don't have to be slimy. You don't have to be sly. You have to be none of these. Okay? So anyone who tells you that you have to do all this to survive in the corporate world is talking through that or doesn't know what the corporate world is all about. Maybe in some companies, at some stage, at some time, maybe with some boss, yes, you have to adapt to that. But for a period of time, and all of you will be working for 25, 30 years and achieving great success in your careers, it all levels out. Be who you are, play your best game, be true to yourself, and be sincere and honest, and try and follow these seven things carefully. There are a lot of books which you read, because it's all correct, it's all right. But these are seven things which I believe work for me, and I share them with you. I have nothing more to say, but I'd just like to end this with four lines, which are, it's an Urdu poem. It's one of my favorite poems in Urdu. It's got very deep meaning. I think it's very relevant for you all. It means that in English, the translation would be take yourself and upgrade yourself, enhance yourself to such a level of excellence that when God wants to give you a fortune, He actually asks you what you want. It's a great state to be in. He's saying raise yourself to that level. That level of excellence that when God wants to give you something, He'll actually ask you what do you want. The Urdu four lines are Khudi ko kar buland itna, Khudi ko kar buland itna, ki har taqdeer ke pehle Khuda bande se poochhe, bol ke bhi naza kare. Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity. It's been an honor, it's been a pleasure. I wish you the very best in your personal and professional life. I'm sure all of you will do very, very well. Work hard. Believe in yourself. Achieve a lot of success. But remember one thing. Have a lot of fun along the way, okay?
Yes, sir.
In your life, make the journey rewarding and fun. Good luck. Open for any questions that you might want to ask me.
So my question is, according to you, what is that differentiating factor that keeps the top 5% people to be successful or become the CEOs, whereas others to follow or being behind them?
I just spoke about them, yeah.
It was because we all know that. But
you know, what I spoke about, you know, you will read a lot of books like I told you. But what I spoke about is probably common sense. But it's so uncommon that when you start working, you figure out that such less people believe in themselves. Such less people have the commitment to execute what they thought they would. They would like to compromise their integrity. They're careless about their own personal brand. So these are the 6 or 7 things. Finally, when you become a leader, these are 6 or 7 things you do personally, you know, to climb up the corporate ladder, which I think, which has held me in good stead, which has helped me a lot. But when you become a leader and you start managing a team, the thing that differentiates your team or your company from another company in a commoditized industry, in an industry where the products are the same, processes can be replicated, is people. Okay? You need to focus on people. You need to. And by focusing on people, I'm not saying do good things to them all the time, give them great bonuses, give them great increments, give them great salary hikes, keep them really happy. No, just be fair. Be transparent, be fair. If you're be tough at times, be tough. Be merit driven. And people start respecting you. Make it a great place to work for. Have a very glued on, inspired, motivated, sales or employee team. People create difference in today. Because all industries, there's no product or process which cannot be replicated. It's people who cannot be replicated. So that's what makes a difference.
Good evening, sir.
How are you?
Hi. Sir, I'm Sagar Baba from BIMHRD, PM Manager. So my question is related to insurance companies. Actually, it's noted that in India, the insurance are cheaper than the other countries, like in America or US or in UK. But still, the insurance is not accepted, or not many people go in insurance policies. Why is that so?
See, it's a pertinent question. I've asked this question 100 times in the day. One, the awareness of insurance in this country is very low. Hence the penetration of insurance is very low. That is what the insurance industry, the regulator, the finance ministry, the government of India put apart, prime minister schemes. You know, you read about the prime minister scheme, the Chandan Yojana and the Jeevan Jyoti and the Atal Pension scheme. They're trying to increase the awareness and the penetration of insurance so that insurance is taken by the common man. Because insurance is a very critical product every person should have. But the awareness about insurance is starting to build up. That is what all of us in the industry are trying to build up and increase the penetration. In fact, I was at the regulator's office yesterday, and one of the targets for the regulator is to increase penetration of insurance in the country. You know, there's a saying about insurance. There is no wife that thinks husband needs insurance. Because every wife thinks husband is wrong with that. Right? And there's no widow that thought husband had enough insurance. So when that event actually happens, it's going to happen. She wishes that I wish she had taken insurance. So that's reality. Awareness, penetration is low, but the industry effort, the government of India, we're trying to increase it.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Hi.
So I'm from the HR, and I wanted to ask you maybe out of curiosity, generally when you are in a higher level or when you're a leader, you can't make everyone happy. You have to take steps where not many people are happy. When you may have to lay off people, or you may take steps where people are not satisfied for the good of the company. And as an HR, or when I become a leader, how do you think I should react to these things and how to maintain the balance?
What's your name?
Vandana,
very good question. This is a problem that, you know, we have to face day after day. We have to downsize, we have to retrench, we have to lay off, we have to ask for people to leave, we have to cut salaries. These are business realities. As business gets tougher, as bottom lines shrink, as they get more competitive, we have to start reducing costs. But I spoke to my team, I had a town hall with my team 2 days back. And I said, you know, I spoke about doing a lot of people, and I truly want to make my company a thank God it's a Monday place to work. That's one of my goals. And I became CEO 3 years back. I said, along with the other things, the growth across business parameters, I want this to be a great place to work. Okay. But at the same time, the reality is that I did a restructuring where 100 people lost their jobs. I did another restructuring in my head office where another 40 people lost their jobs. But these are business realities. So I spoke to my team and they asked me a question, like you asking me today, that you speak about thank God it's a Monday place to work, and you think about doing great things for people, but you're laying off people. Is that fair? So I told them that as a CEO, what my company owes you, what we owe you, is to build a healthy, vibrant, top-class company that you are proud to work in. That is what we all do. We want to build a company that is respected so that you will be respected working for us. That is what I owe you. I owe you giving you opportunities, equal opportunities. I owe you giving you training. I owe you giving you inputs. I owe you rewarding and recognizing you when you do a job well. And I owe you picking you up, dusting you when you fail, and sending you back to battle and motivating you. That is what I owe you. I don't owe you the job. You know the difference? You have to be very clear. You don't owe people the job. You will owe them everything to make them successful. But that job is not his.
This would be the last question of the session.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. My name is Jinkan. I am BIMHRD marketing student. So my question is, Policy Bazaar and other online platform which sells policy, and now right now insurance sector is an open market. So it is more helpful to sell online rather than traditional.
See, online policies are cheaper. The only online product in life insurance, in non-life, you know, motor, health, travel are all. A lot of people buy online due to the convenience. But the only product in life insurance which is sold online, predominantly online, is term. So it's term and easy to understand. So online policies offer you a lower price, the convenience of doing it from your house, the convenience of comparing that company to other companies. So if you're an internet user, if you're enlightened, you're savvy about using net, I think online is a great place to go for term policy. But there are other insurance policies which are more complicated, which are more complex, which will require an understanding, which will require an eyeball-to-eyeball sale, where you need to contact your agent or your banker. A term policy is a simple commoditized product, dependent on the price, you can do it online. But a lot of insurance products are long-term, need a lot of understanding, explanations, and for that you need intervention.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We learned about commitment, simplicity, attitude, change, complexity, reinventing ourselves, and many more. Sir, we look forward to many more such interactions on and off the campus.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Dr. K.K. Valluri, Director BITM, to present memento to Mr. Vighnesh Shahane.
Help us to nurture our career. We are very thankful to all the corporate stalwarts who spared their valuable time to contribute to the learning of the future managers from Sri Balaji Society. To conclude, may I now request Unnati Rayapurulu, student manager, BIMHRD, to propose a vote of thanks.
Good evening. Respected dignitaries, faculties, and dear student manager. It gives me immense gratification to conclude the second day of the 12th National Business Convention 2016 on a successful note. The learnings we have gathered here will certainly aid us to climb the corporate ladder and fulfill our goals. I would like to take a moment to thank all the guest speakers for the day, dignitaries on and off the dais, and student managers for their cooperation and enthusiasm. Thank you.